when they start to gain a little bit of trust in you, the facilitator, in that you are not there to get at them, or that you're not taking sides, or that you're not going to tell them that they're wrong, and help them see and feel that what they say is not going to be criticized, that you're encouraging lots of opinion from people, often these things melt away quite quickly.
The question is from Thinking Focus.
Hi, I'm Paul from Thinking Focus.
Hi, I'm Rich from Thinking Focus.
And hi, I'm Rob from Thinking Focus.
And the question is, how do I handle difficult people without impacting the whole group? Now, this is one of our short series around facilitation skills. We do a lot of facilitation. I've got two master facilitators in front of me, Rob and Rich, and I'm going to pick their brains and find out a little bit more so that you can get some idea of how to facilitate better. So, how do you handle difficult people without impacting the whole group?
Well, the first thing is, I find, don't invite them. If only it was that easy. But of course, we do come across difficult people.
Yeah.
And sometimes they show their hand quite early.
Yeah, they do. Like in this podcast, where you ask a very sensible question and you get that.
I think if they show themselves quite early in a workshop, it's often a sign of some anxiety about maybe the topic that they you're working on, or how they perceive the topic, or how they perceive their place in the group, or, to give you another one, how they perceive the facilitator might be coming at it, if that makes sense.
Yeah, so give me some examples of what, when you say show themselves early, what kind of things would they do?
You might get someone right at the beginning of the workshop whose body language isn't great. It might be as simple as, you know, people walk in the room and say hello to each other and chat with each other before you get going. Maybe they don't. Maybe they just come in, take a seat. You can tell body language isn't good. They're not talking to others. Maybe at the beginning when you're talking about what you're going to do, and if you have to sort of do any sort of introductions, because not everyone always knows each other, they're very short in what they say. So you're reading a lot of a lot of the non-verbals, which is kind of telling you that very early on that this person isn't as comfortable as they might be.
And there's a couple of classics as well, where people will immediately respond to something that's going on in the room. So, for example, we tend to, don't we, remove furniture. We tend not to want to have barriers with people having tables, etc., in the room.
Yeah.
And have an open sort of seating plan. And you know, this isn't a sign necessarily of a difficult person, but somebody who's likely to be reacting against being at that session in the first place will more than likely actually make some reference to the fact that, you know, this reminds me of their last AA meeting that they went to, or what's this, a counseling session, or they'll drop some sort of remark about what the environment seems to be indicating to them, you know, based again on perception. So it's just, I guess, you know, you're probably the same, Rich. You're looking out for signs of acceptance of the environment and acceptance of the group, and whether or not somebody is going to be challenging or not be comfortable in that environment.
I think you're right, Robert. I think we have to pick ourselves up here on our own language, because what we've said is, how do I handle difficult people? Well, actually, two things in that. One, we don't handle people, do we? We work with them.
Yeah.
So I think that's probably, we have to pick ourselves up there. And difficult people, I don't suppose there are such things as difficult people. What there are, and we're all in this bracket from time to time, we all feel uncomfortable,
yeah,
anxious, you know, on edge, might be same as anxious, whatever, about something that we're going to do. And that doesn't mean you're a difficult person. It just means that what we've got to do is try and meet them where they're at and understand where that's coming from. And sometimes early in a workshop, we pick up on all that stuff that we've just described. Sometimes if you can work with that person, it sorts itself out quite quickly when they start to gain a little bit of trust in you, the facilitator, in that you are not there to get at them, or that you're not taking sides, or that you're not going to tell them that they're wrong. So if you can build trust and help them see and feel that what they say is not going to be criticized, that you're encouraging lots of opinion from people, often these things melt away quite quickly.
Well, definitely. I mean, one of the early things we do, of course, is to get them talking early, don't we? You know, and I'm saying the whole group, not just the supposedly difficult person, but the whole group contributing early so that somebody who might be feeling anxious, and I think that's a brilliant description you've given, you know, because their difficultness might be hiding an anxiety about belonging. If you get everybody involved in introducing each other or saying things up, you know, quite early, so it's not just facilitator heavy, then that's a great leveler for everybody. You get that sense of belonging established quite quickly.
So what I'm hearing here is there's a couple of things going on. So one you're sort of talking about that some people are difficult, and I'm doing air quotes, even though you can't see me on a podcast doing air quotes, difficult people because they're anxious. And that might actually not be about the topic. It might be about the process. It might be what's going to actually happen in this room, and am I going to get it right, and all that kind of stuff.
One of the things that you often get is you could misread that someone's not engaged in the topic or feeling that the topic's difficult or that, you know, they're concerned about stuff, when actually it's just that they're mentally not in the room because maybe they're so busy they don't think they've got time for this conversation. And I think you do get that sometimes. People first 10, 15 minutes have got to let go of what they were doing and the busy day that they've got to engage in a discussion that you've got going on. And a lot of this comes back to the setup. How has it been set up? If you set it up right, and quite often you go through all the steps to set it up right and still people don't turn up knowing what's happening. But if you set it up right and you work through the process of making sure everyone knows what we're doing and why we're doing it, and if they've got concerns, they can talk to you beforehand, then you can overcome some of this before you even get in the room.
Definitely.
So are you saying, in essence, then, actually, sometimes people come in, they're in the wrong frame of mind, but the thing that makes them difficult in that workshop or not actually is more about how you deal with that in the first 15 minutes, half hour of the workshop, than it is about them?
Yeah, I would say, you know, and this is a chip on the shoulder time for to a degree for me, is that it's, you know, look at yourself first, look at the facilitator. Because if the facilitator is at the front and not actually engaging, creating the environment, showing some empathy, not thinking about how they're going to involve the group, then surely 80% or more of that is down to the facilitator not really being in tune with the people that they're going to have some responsibility for learning for.
Yeah, early in any workshop or meeting that you're facilitating, there's a period when you as the facilitator have to put all the energy in.
Yeah.
And you have to lead with your own energy. So by that, you have to take the lead. You have to demonstrate that you are, I don't mean in charge, but demonstrate that you're leading.
No, it's a quiet confidence. It's a relaxation. It's an engagement.
Yeah, with a quiet confidence. And you have to set the tone in terms of energy. So I think if you do that, and through that process, put people at ease, you'll start to see it reflecting back to you as the workshop goes on.
Yeah.
I think if you don't do that early on, and if you don't take, with that quiet confidence, take control of the session, the group lose confidence in you, and that can make it very difficult for you if that happens.
Yeah.
So what are you doing at that point? Obviously, you're putting all the energy in. So you're creating trust. Is that where the vulnerability comes in? What's really happening in that early part?
I think you're doing all that. I think what you're trying to do is to create trust, create a safe environment, demonstrate to the group that when you're facilitating, this is about them. It's not about you. I think you're trying to do all that stuff.
You're welcome. I mean, this might be a poor analogy, but I'm going to go with it anyway. You're welcoming, you know, a guest into your environment, aren't you? I mean, if somebody came to your house that you'd invited to your house, you would be polite. You would be welcoming. You would offer them a drink. You would make them feel at home and relaxed. And although that's stretching it a little bit when it comes to facilitating a group, the same principles should apply. You know, you've got a group of people who at that point in time, even though you've done lots of preparation, to Rich's point before, you would hope you have done lots of preparation, they don't really know what to expect. And those in those first 15 minutes, they're sort of going, oh, what's going to be happening here then? So you sort of have to help them to understand this is what's happening here then, and this is how we're going to run things.
Yeah, so you're doing all that stuff, creating trust, creating a safe environment. People have a number of questions, don't they, when they come in, that they might subconsciously got in their heads. What's this about? Who's this person? If they don't, we're often an external facilitator. So who's this person? Why are they here?
Why should I be listening to them?
What do they know? And it's not about what we know. We're there to work through the process, whatever the process is. Who else is here? Why are they here? What's expected of me? All those things are going through people's mind. And you know, we often make a joke, don't we, at the beginning of a meeting, workshop, whatever, because the first question you will have is, when will this finish? Because that is a question people have in their heads.
Yeah.
And I think quite often when, you know, you go, we'll be finished at 3:30 or whatever it is.
And then they get to question, lunch, don't they?
Yeah.
Will I get fed?
Will I get fed is another one quite often. Is there going to be a break? And another one, you know, because people have got calls to make or things to do. So I think there are some obvious questions that you can answer, but then there are other questions, starting with, why are we here? Why are we doing this? What's the point? Now, that one we might not answer. What we do is sort of say, you might be thinking this, I'm going to invite whoever's sort of sponsoring the meeting just to give us a bit of context and flavour. And then you can build on that then. So that setup is important at the beginning.
So in essence, what you're doing there is making sure that you're not creating difficult people.
Yeah.
You're handling all of the things in their head. So actually you can get them to the point where they can go, oh, okay, I get all that. Yeah, all right, I'll just be part of this meeting for a while.
Yeah, or if I am, and let's just keep on using the label difficult, if I am still not convinced, at least I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt for the next 20 minutes, half an hour. You know, so I'm not going to launch into my potential negative attitude right from the outset. You've got, you know, I'm going to give the facilitator here a bit of a benefit of the doubt for a short while until they say something or do something that proves to me that my negativity is well justified.
Now, I'm going to move on a little bit from that. So we've got the environment set up. We've done the opening bit right. We've kind of decreased our probability of accidentally creating a negative person. But from time to time, we've all met, you know, somebody who basically, you know, walks into the room and
doesn't want to be there.
Yeah, I mean, they're somewhere between Eeyore and a dementor. You know, just, you know, from popular fiction. So often they don't, you know, come straight out of the blocks and go, I'm going to fight you. They give a little bit of time and then they kind of turn up and start moaning about everything. So let's talk about those guys or girls. How do you handle them? What do you do with those guys?
Well, I think the first thing is to let them have a couple of wins early. So I think one of the worst things a facilitator can do if a challenge is being put forward in a group is to challenge back, you know, or to sort of bounce that challenge back in a way that turns into a contest between who's right here and who's the strongest here.
Right.
So you sort of have to let the person say what it is they want to say or do what it is they want to do, but perhaps with one eye on what's the impact on the group, because there may very well be somebody in the group who decides that person shouldn't get away with that, or, you know, wants to actually contain it in their way. But I think on the other side, to sort of think about what is it that really is the basis for that person's challenge. So I typically find that if somebody's saying something that seems slightly contentious or maybe a microaggression, is to ask a couple of questions on the back of that to see what the analogy here is, give them enough rope to see whether or not they're going to actually, you know, trip over that piece of rope. So you need to be able to give them some questions and some to expand the thought to see whether or not actually they're just creating a challenge, or if it's something that needs to be explored and it's something relevant to the topic.
Right, so you're basically looking here to go, are you just being awkward, or is there a frustration behind this and you're just, it's coming out in the wrong way?
Absolutely. I mean, I've been in one particular session that sticks out where a guy, and, you know, classic negative body language, folded arms and looking a bit grumpy and not engaging with other discussion that might have been.
I was going to say, Rob, he's on the call.
Ricky's not here today.
Yeah, but he muttered under his breath, you know, and I'm not going to swear, but he swore, well, this is all a load of, isn't it? You know, but he muttered it under his breath in like an actor's aside so that all of his colleagues would hear and I would hear as the facilitator.
And I think if, they see, depending on, obviously I can't see the context, but if that happened, I would, in the way I'm imagining it, Rob, this obviously wasn't there, but if that happened, I would be tempted to say to that person, let's call him Ricky, I'd be tempted to say,
that's interesting. What makes you say that?
Yeah, Ricky, that's really interesting because you feel quite strongly about that. Do you mind sharing with us why you feel that way? So yes, we can, you know, we can discuss it. Because that'll do one of two things. Either they'll say, oh, no, and they won't. And that makes them realise that actually what they
have just done is made a bit of an idiot of themselves, yeah.
Yeah. Or they've got something genuine to share and they can share whatever it is. And then you can build more trust by opening that out for some discussion. What tends to happen when that comes about is it's not left just to you as the facilitator to deal with it, but the rest of the group will start to say, hey, Ricky, I agree with that. I think you're right, you know, but have you thought about this? Or someone else will say, well, no, Ricky, come on, you're wrong. We do, you know, and that will cause the discussion that actually, let's be honest, is really worthwhile and possibly the thing that you're there for.
Yeah, absolutely. But I mean, equally, I've been in sessions, as I'm sure you guys have, where we're not the facilitator and where some challenge has come from, you know, another delegate, and the facilitator has pounced on it straight away quite strongly. And you sort of go, ooh, you're making a rod for your own back here, because it's just turning into a competition between the facilitator and the person.
Sometimes people perceive themselves to be difficult.
Yes.
Right. So, and I'm sure we've all had this where someone comes up and says, look, I'm always the difficult person. And you kind of go, okay, all right. And they perceive themselves to be difficult and therefore are quite negative in the way they put things across. And Rob, you said something before about let them have a couple of wins early. So I've found over the years that if you identify there's a person that seems quite negative, but they might like to speak out, by letting them speak out a couple of times and say a couple of things and not shut them down and not jump on it, but after the finish to say something like, interesting point, Ricky, thank you for that. Perhaps we'll come back to that in a little bit. And then they do it again and you say, really interesting question. What does everyone else think? What you're starting to do is take this power away from them of I'm negative and I'm going to be a problem, which some people bring on purpose. You take that away from them because you're saying, that's quite interesting. That's a good point. Let's discuss that, which leaves them in this funny place because they're kind of going, actually, I'm being listened to.
Yeah. And actually, it's a really interesting point you raised there because I've experienced that with people. And often the people who are the most angry haven't thought the next step. So when you do listen to them and go, okay, so what does that mean? Or what are you going to do about it? Or how could we fix that? They've never done that piece of thinking because they're just too busy shouting at everybody.
Yeah. And that's not a criticism of them. It might be because they feel so emotional and don't feel like they're being listened to.
Yeah.
So I think
they've never been allowed to get this far before, have they?
Yeah, because they've been shut down or maybe they've been told at some point that they're too negative or too difficult. So I think, as you said, Rob, one of the things is not to see that as a problem, but to see that as a, okay, let's talk about that because that's an interesting point. And it sort of gets them on side, makes them realise I'm being listened to and we're going to talk about this. Now, and as you say, Paul, quite often they haven't got the answer.
Yes.
But that's all right as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I'm curious as well, and I want to sort of move slightly from difficult people to, I'm going to say, strong characters. Yeah, so they're not necessarily being awkward, but there are, you know, we come across people in workshops all the time who are clearly, you know, very vocal, very opinionated, very strong in their character and their approach to things that can cause other people to shut down. How do you handle those guys?
I think one of the things that is useful there and is not to have big periods of time where you're creating, if you like, a stage and an audience environment, you know, because, you know, what do we tend to do as facilitators? We tend to have a whole bunch of smaller group discussions over a period of a day or a couple of days, whatever the time period is that we're working with a group, so that you know, some learning is happening, some peer exchange is happening, some feedback and take back is happening. And it's not just a, you know, a whole group with the facilitator doing the bulk of the, if you like, the talking or the input. It's a shared experience by everybody. So, you know, a person like that in smaller groups, you are reducing the amount of, if you like, time available for them to hold forth, to hold the floor, hold the audience, giving them the airtime, because you're reducing that possibility. So that's one thing that you can do, one thing that we do.
Yeah, putting them in groups with other people that won't be easily led.
Right.
Is a good thing to do. If you break out to have a discussion, make sure they're not with people that they'll railroad.
Mm-hmm.
So you've got to sort of think about the characters. I also think if you create a good environment and everyone's sort of okay, but you've got a strong character that's talking a lot, and you've got to sort of know what you're doing to do this. But if you can, with a bit of humour, ask a question to the group and then say, what do we think? And you might look at, let's say it's, I don't know, Emily this time that's talking a lot. You might look and say, what does everyone think other than Emily? And you might look and have a bit of a laugh at that. And you've got to do that in the right way. But then most people will laugh and then other people will talk. Because what you've said in a gentle way is, thanks, Emily, we've had your contribution, sort of thing. So other things that you can do, very, very subtle other things, is if, let's just say, Emily, in this case, is sat to your left and you're at the front of the room, is you could say, right, what do we think? But turn your body and open your arms out to the other side of the room.
Yeah.
Oh, so you're almost using your body to direct the conversation.
Yeah.
So you're saying, someone from over here, what do you think? Or even, you know, if you're standing facing everyone, just not point, but sort of raise your arm to one side and say, what do we think?
Yeah.
Because what you're doing is you're saying, I need an answer from over here. So that can mean that strong character that's constantly talking this to your left will, the sort of subconscious thing is, they've read your body language.
Yeah. So as a facilitator, your presence controls a lot of the conversation.
Absolutely.
I mean, one of the other things you can do, if somebody really will not stop talking and jumping in, of course you can ask them in the break. You can say, hey, look, Emily, you've made some great points. I want to hear from a few other people. Is that all right if you sort of support me in listening to everyone else in the next bit? They'll nearly 99% of the time say yes to that. Or go and stand behind them. So if you go and stand behind the chair they're sat in and ask the group a question from there, often you find they don't respond then.
Yeah.
Because you're talking sort of over the top of their head to everybody else, and you find that other people will respond. So all those are little things that are worth trying. Speaking to them and saying, hey, look, you know, do you mind just supporting me and doing a bit of listening to the next question, because you've had a lot to say and I want to hear from others. It's probably one of your last resorts, really. I'd try some of the other things first, but that's always an option.
I mean, you covered some of this before, Rich, anyway, in the sort of generalized comment, and I don't mean that in that way, as a general tip. Involving the rest of the group is a great deflector of that type of person, you know, and you've repeated that two or three times in that last description. What does everybody else think is a very, you know, non-aggressive and very easy way of being able to actually sort of say, although this person is holding forth, although this person might have a lot to say, I am inviting everybody else to comment on what that person is saying. So you know, and then obviously you've given some other examples, very specific to other tips if that isn't working. So a general rule of thumb is, involve the group. You know, don't see that as an individual who's trying to challenge the facilitator.
And there's often signs of this, because you're trying to pick up on everything, but one sign that the group are a bit fed up with somebody, and let's bear in mind that these people might all be working together and you're an external facilitator and you've come in, so you don't always know the background. But one sign early on is if somebody says something and you see two or three people rolling their eyes and then you think, oh, that was interesting. And then you carry on a bit and then you see it again. You kind of go in, they've not got any patience for this person's opinion. So that then would would mean to me that not that I need to necessarily shut that person up, but the people that are rolling their eyes, I'd need to call that out and I'd need to say, hey, look, you know, Janine, when Rob was talking then, I could just see that you didn't quite disagree. Do you mind sharing what you were thinking? And again, she might say, oh, no, it's fine. But typically they will say something. And then you've called out that behaviour, because some of the subtle behaviours like that are often an issue when you're trying to deal with a topic. And that's your job as a facilitator to try and pick up on it and call it out.
Yeah.
Okay, last question for me as we round this one off, because I know anybody listening to this is going to be thinking, particularly if they've not facilitated much. Yeah, but there could be that one person, that person in my business. I'm going to call them Boris, and I don't know where that name came up. Who just is really difficult and is really hard to deal with. So I've got two-part question. Firstly, you guys in the 200 years you've been facilitating or whatever it is, have done thousands of events and workshops. How often has that really happened, that there's been a Boris-type character in the room?
For me, twice in 33 years of facilitation.
So not very often?
No.
Yes, similar. I'm thinking now, once maybe when it's been really bad.
Yeah. So firstly, to sort of go, even though it's probably an obvious fear to have when you know, particularly if you're not a confident facilitator or you're doing it, you know, in your organization, it's very, very rare.
Yes.
And I'm just curious, just to round off the podcast, what did you do in that situation?
On both occasions for me, and in slightly different ways, after going through some of the things that we've been advising to try to get that person on side, I gave both of those people the choice about whether they would like to remain or not.
Yeah.
So literally said, you just don't look like you want to be here.
Absolutely. You're not enjoying yourself. It doesn't look like you're getting anything out of this. I feel responsible that I might be wasting your time here. So listen, if you don't want to be here, that's absolutely fine with me. And on both those occasions, that's what I did. Interestingly, they both did leave. And one of them was marched back into the room by their line manager 10 minutes later.
Brilliant. Very similar. I think if I think back to that, I tried speaking to them in the breaks, not in a way to say what's the problem, but to kind of, you know, try and get to know them a bit more. So you're having a break, go and stand next to them, having a cup of coffee and have a little chat with them, to try and just understand them a bit more and break the ice a bit. Still, that and some of the other stuff still didn't work. So in the next, I think we reached a point when there was quite a strong disagreement. So I said, look, let's take five and just cool off a bit. Went and had a conversation with them and pretty much did what Rob did and said, look, clearly you're struggling with this. It's okay if you want to stay and carry on, but we need to make some progress. It's okay if you don't want to be here. It's up to you. I'll leave you with it. But, you know, we'd like you in the room. We'd like your contribution, that sort of stuff. And they came back. They came back and carried on from there. And it took a while, but got better after a very difficult start.
Mm.
But so I think, as you said, Rob, just that act of having that conversation said, look, you're struggling. We'd like you to contribute. But if you don't want to, that's fine too. But we've got to make some progress on this topic. It's not because what you've got to be careful of is not going, yes, you've succeeded. You've derailed all this. Well done. We're going to stop. I think you need to point out we're going to carry on. If you want to be part of that, you're welcome. If you don't, that's also fine, but we're carrying on, sort of thing.
So on that point,
because that's, well, sorry, Paul, I know you're just going to close out, but, you know, I think the link back to the beginning, you know, you asked us, how do we handle difficult people without impacting the whole group? And that's it. We have a responsibility as a facilitator for the rest of the group to get something out of this, not, you know, for not one person to derail it. So, you know, that keeping that responsibility at the forefront of our mind is a very helpful thing.
I'll tell you one last thing. I've also had silent assassins who play along and everything seems fine. And then afterwards, it comes out that they were extremely, you know, unhappy and this wasn't good and that wasn't good and they weren't happy about this and blah, blah, blah. I've had that once or twice in a certain industry that I've done quite a bit of work in. And the only thing to do with that is, and this was a, you know, we'll get back together a number of times, is to then call them out one-on-one, have a conversation with them, say, well, apparently you're really unhappy, yet you said nothing in the room. You chose to do it afterwards. How does, you know, and almost that, how does that help? If you don't talk to me during the process, how can I avoid some of that? So that was a case of having to be quite forceful, because some of that behaviour I thought was unacceptable, to sit in the room and say everything was fine and then slag it off afterwards.
Yeah.
I didn't feel was particularly helpful.
Yeah.
For anyone.
Sorry about that, Rich. I won't do it again.
Okay. Like, I'm just going to very neatly summarise. It's three things we've really talked about. So the first is quite a lot of dealing with the whole context of difficult people is in the setup. That first 15 or 20 minutes that you can establish the trust and get rid of a lot of the questions can deal with quite a lot of the challenges you're going to get later. The second is to, you know, when you see that behaviour, don't ignore it. You know, use it. Ask people questions. What are you thinking? Involve people. Let them have a little bit of rope, because that might actually lead you somewhere. And the final bit for me was, don't get too hung up on the idea that there might be some complete ogre in the room, because it's really, really rare. And when it does happen, you can just call them out on it and go, well, you don't have to be here. If you want to go, you can go. So thank you, guys. That's been a really fascinating topic. I know I've learned a load. Of how to handle you two. So hopefully next time in the podcast, I won't be sitting here worrying about difficult people.
Should have said that. It doesn't work on us.
I can't find out.
I can't wait for Paul to stop the recording button so that I can tell you, Rich, just how bad I thought that all was.
Next time on The Question Is.
So if you're talking about a particular subject and it might get quite tense, then I might break the group up into smaller groups, which is a good way of, you know, helping people share what they think without thinking they've got to do it in front of everyone, particularly if it's something that's controversial.
To find out how Thinking Focus can unlock the potential within your organization, go to www.thinkingfocus.com, where you'll discover more about the work we do, helping our clients increase productivity and enable change.